Zero trust means that you shouldn't trust a person or device on the internal network any more than some random person or device on the internet. You go through three steps in establishing zero trust. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we discuss the concepts behind cybersecurity. Today, we briefly discuss zero trust. Everybody seems to have their own definition of zero trust, and so do I. I'll provide a simple and actionable definition to get you started on your zero trust journey. The term zero trust means that you shouldn't trust a person or device on the internal network any more than some random person or device on the internet. To achieve the security goal, zero trust disentangles authentication from authorization. But let's first look at how most organizations do it today, where they're very much entangled. A typical organization today runs Active Directory to do a number of things. Authenticate users, often using password, optionally second factor authentication, to map those users to groups, to assign permissions to each of those groups or users, and also to maintain a directory of devices. So a single centralized system to do all your authentication and authorization needs. While this fully centralized approach does sound like an easy, straightforward solution, it does generally lead to insecurities. And that's because the central administrators just don't know what permission individual users or groups should be getting. A central Active Directory admin will assign users to groups, often based on HR information. This person is in finance, this person is in IT, say. But that admin doesn't know specifically what that individual needs access to. And in fact, only people in the respective teams know their business processes and know who needs to access what and how that evolves over time. Hence, any system that maintains authorization information in a centralized manner gravitates towards over-permissiveness. Users accumulate permissions just by virtue of being part of some team, not because they need access. The sprawl and permission can often be pruned through audits, but those are irregular and a lot of work. Moving to zero trust decentralizes this responsibility and lets those people decide who needs to access systems who have the subject matter expertise, each individual team or each application owner. So let's start from this typical company where everything is centralized in Active Directory. You go through three steps in establishing zero trust. First, you decide on your authentication system. This is either your good old Active Directory, if you're already using it, or one of these newer identity providers. If you're starting from scratch, you'll probably use a more focused tool. If you're already in Active Directory, you might stay there just because the migration is a lot of work. Step two, and this is the complicated one, it comes at most effort. You enable each of the application teams or each of the business units to maintain their own permissions. This is a technology and a process question. Technology-wise, they need to be able to maintain access rights somehow. Newer SaaS applications often come with their own permission system, but as you're going towards old and older applications, you might need to put a proxy server in between. An access proxy, that is, because all applications tend to have generic roles, let's say a user, an admin, and a super admin, and you need an access proxy in between to map individual accounts to these user permission groups. And you need an access proxy to map individual users to these generic users. There are commercial privileged identity management solutions that tend to be expensive. And then there's open source solutions like Apache Guacamole, who do the job fine in almost all cases. So that's the technology side. Process, though, you have to go one team at a time and make sure this team understands their responsibility in setting access rights for every member of their team and every application that they're responsible for. And not just that, they also need to feel responsible for keeping access rights at a minimum. So you can't get rid of the audits quite yet. You still have to check on teams that they fulfill their responsibilities. So these were the main two steps. Choose your central authentication system and enable teams decentrally to set the authorization permissions to any application that is critical to your business. The last step is somewhat optional, but really helps increase hacking resilience. And that is disentangling users from devices. In Active Directory, user and device information is bunched up in a single directory, which means that user information is basically broadcasted to any computer in your organization, giving access to hackers in a very simple fashion. So you want to disentangle those. You could disentangle into two different Active Directories, one for devices and one for users. And often one of those would be your cloud Active Directory, to which you're migrating anyway. And one of them can be your legacy on-premise Active Directory. Alternatively, you can migrate your users to a more pure play identity provider and keep your devices in Active Directory. Either way can starve hackers of the information that currently they have access to. So why do people like Zero Trust so much if it puts so much more responsibility in the hands of so many more people? Well, first of all, because those people actually know what to do with that responsibility. Each individual team knows who needs access to what and how that evolves over time. Secondly, you can remove some security controls that are hard to maintain and costly as well. For instance, firewalls. You don't really need firewalls anymore if anybody on your internal networks is treated like somebody on the internet. In our video on network segregation, we still find a few cases where you need firewalls, but by and large, you can get rid of most of them. Third, you allow the authentication team to really focus on authentication, bring in the latest and greatest in multi-factor authentication, test device identities, include whatever location information and other context you can in having a really strong authentication, rather than overloading the authentication function with busy work around authorization, which takes away attention from what they should be good at, and that's authentication. Last but not least, use cases like work from home, work from hotel, work from airport become a lot easier because wherever people are, they're always treated exactly the same. They have to go through central authentication, and then authorization happens decentrally by application. And some of these applications might decide you're not allowed to access when you're in another country or at certain hours or what have you. The security team should support exactly those decisions as to what are the most critical applications that need the most constraints. So once again, Zero Trust is centralizing identity and authentication while decentralizing authorization and access. By doing that, you allow security people to focus on what they are good at and business units to focus on what they have expertise in. I hope these thoughts will help you cut through the jungle of Zero Trust and get started on your journey. As the next video to watch, I can recommend our discussion on how to get started on identity management and how to set up those centralized processes. If you have any feedback, we look forward to reading it below. And until then, happy hacking.